We continue our discussion. So the first part I talked about how Brahma set up a test for Krishna. And he left him completely alone to check what Krishna would do. And initially, Krishna as a part of his Leela appeared bewildered. He appeared as if he's confused. So now Bhishmacharya Thakur analyzes that there are times in Krishna's Leela when he seems confused, when he seems bewildered. So how does this happen? So the whole purpose of Leela is the reciprocation of love. Now in this case, it is Krishna's loving concern for the cows. Where have they gone? It is his loving concern for his cowherds. Where have they gone? So that is this loving concern. If Krishna, that loving concern cannot be manifested if Krishna manifests his omniscience. Oh, I know what has happened. So in Vrajalila, God's omniscience or God's omnipotence, it is subordinated to the Leela, to the purpose of reciprocating love. It is not eliminated, it is not lost, it is subordinated. That means Krishna chooses to act as if he is not omniscient, chooses to act as if he is ignorant. The whole idea of Leela is that whatever is needed to flavor the emotion, to further the pastime, to deepen the experience, Krishna does that. And the agency which arranges for this is Yogamaya. In the Bhagavatam, at the start of the Rasleela, in the first verse, in the 29th chapter, it described Yogamayam Upashritaha. Now that is a very striking verse, that because the whole Bhagavatam is meant for demonstrating how Krishna is the supreme ashray and everything is ashrita, everything is sheltered by him. So now, but in the 10th canto, what is being said is that the ashray has now taken the, so one who is the ashray, he has become ashrit. One who is the supreme shelter is taking shelter of someone else. How does that happen? That is Krishna's special arrangement through Yoga Maya. The word Maya, what does it mean? That which is not, yes. That means you could say illusion. That which causes us to perceive that which is not the reality. Maya, not this, it is not like this. Now what does the word yoga mean?
Connection.
Connection. So now if you see, literally yoga maya is like an oxymoron. It's two opposite words. Maya is the illusion that takes us away from God. And yoga is the process that brings a connection with God. So yoga maya, what is this? Illusion and connection, they're two opposites. So oxymoron means two opposite words that are brought together to convey some point. Say if somebody makes a point and you want to criticize that point, you say, that was a brilliantly stupid point. What? Was it brilliant or was it stupid? You normally don't put brilliantly stupid point. That means, say, there is some amount of brilliance, but the conclusion that you have drawn is stupid. So, there are many oxymorons which are used to convey deeper truths. One of the most common oxymorons, or one of the most not common, most meaningful oxymorons is that suicide is an act of courageous cowardice. Now, why courageous cowardice? Because actually, to end one's life for any cause, we all love life, and to end life requires courage. And because of that, the number of people who attempt suicide are much more than the number of people who actually commit suicide. Somebody might decide, I'm going to end my life. And maybe they lie down on a railway track. And then they hear the thunderous sound of the railway coming. And as it comes closer and closer and closer, they get up and say, maybe another time, and go away from there. So, that courage is required for ending one's life. But if that courage is exhibited for some higher cause, maybe somebody is drowning and at the risk of one's life, you go and save that person. And the Twin Towers were falling, the firefighters, despite the risk of getting burnt and crushed, they ran in to save their lives. So that's courage. But when we are risking or losing our life for something which is not really courageous, life is so problematic, I can't face these problems. So that is somewhat cowardly. So courageous cowardice means the act of ending the life is courageous, but the reason why one is ending the life is not courageous. So that's courageous cowardice. So so similarly, just as courageous cowardice is an oxymoron, yoga maya is also an oxymoron. And what yoga maya means essentially is that this is the illusion that strengthens the connection. Normally, illusion disconnects us. Illusion removes the connection. But the illusion that strengthens connection is yoga maya. So here the illusion is that Yashodamai thinks that Krishna is my child. And if I don't feed Krishna, he will die of hunger. That is an illusion. But that deepens her connection. Now the significant point is that yoga maya affects not only the Vrajavasis but also Krishna. That love can be one way, but a loving relationship has to be two ways. Unless there is some reciprocation, you cannot really have a loving relationship. So the Vrajavasis love Krishna, and if they are in that illusion, divine illusion, that Krishna is not God. But if Krishna is always conscious that I am God, then he can't reciprocate appropriately. Now, every relationship requires the appropriate reciprocation. A lot of confusion happens in a relationship if a person suddenly changes roles. Say, if we are having some trouble and we share our heart with a friend, and that friend suddenly, people wear different caps, that friend suddenly changes the caps and becomes authority figure. So, hey, you done this? I'm going to report. That was not the point over here, I told you this. So if people suddenly change the roles, then the relationship can't move forward. So if somebody is confessing their vulnerability and then the other person is in the mood of fault finding, then it's like the conversation, it can't move forward. So similarly, for Krishna's relationship with the Vrajavasis, Krishna himself is also willing to come under yoga maya. That means he also forgets that I am God. He forgets that I am omniscient. Now this forgetfulness is not like our forgetfulness, because Krishna is always God. Yesterday I think I mentioned about, does anyone remember the metaphor of a play? Yesterday, so Krishna is like the actor, then
Yogamaya is the director, but Krishna is the script writer.
Yes, Krishna is the main player, Krishna is the Yogamaya is the director, but Krishna is the script writer. So Krishna forgets that he is God by his will. So now here, for this past, so normally whenever we are acting, especially when we are interacting with multiple people, actually the more broader network of relationships we are in, the more complicated every action can become. Because I might act in a particular way with a particular intention with this person, I might act in a particular way with you, but what my action will be, how my action will be seen by someone else, by person A, person B, person Z, we don't know. So actually when we are acting with one person, we are also acting with other people. Other people are also seeing what is going on. and they are also drawing meaning from it. And that's why the more visible a person becomes, the more their actions come under critical scrutiny. Sometimes we might see somebody very wealthy, very powerful, very famous, and we might feel some envy or jealousy for that person. Actually, the person we feel jealous of is largely a product of our imagination. That means we think this person is so happy, so powerful, so strong, but things become so complicated. The more influential a person becomes, that every action is, it's interpreted by different people in different ways. And it becomes very complicated. So now in the case of Krishna, he at one level is interacting with the Vrajavasis. And within that, he's searching, oh, where are the cows? Where are the gopas? So Krishna is continuing his reciprocation. Now Brahmaji has come in. And Brahmaji has acted to, you could say, disrupt that interaction. So normally, say we are talking with one person in a particular way. Say if sometimes somebody asks me a technical question and I get a little carried away. And I start answering the question very technically in the class. And I get excited answering that question, but then after a few minutes I start noticing all glazed eyes around me. Everybody seems to be looking at me as if they are watching a foreign language movie with no subtitles. Now, so then I have to stop reciprocating with only that person. I have to think about other people also. Then maybe I'll finish the answer, I'll say we'll talk more later, something like that. So at this point, Krishna is reciprocating with the gopas. And while he's reciprocating with the gopas and the cows, and then he's not able to find anyone anywhere. And then, oh. So when one thing is going on, and it goes on well, we might get involved in it. But if something, get some vibes, it's not going on properly. Then you start thinking about other things also. So Krishna, when he's not able to find either of them, this is strange. What's going on over here? Normally, whenever anything happens, we look for an explanation for that. And this is a big subject, but I'll just mention it briefly here, that whatever event happens, we try to fit it in some causal box. Causal box means, say for example, right now, if I'm sitting here, and suddenly this light goes off. Then maybe I look, did I lean against a wall and accidentally switch off the light, or did somebody lean against the wall and switch off the light? So one causal box could be that this light went off because somebody switched off the light. But if that's not happened, the power switch is still on, then I would look, okay, has the power supply itself in this room gone off? That could be another causal box. Or I could say, oh, maybe this light has got spoiled. That is another causal box. So the light has gone off, the same, when we see a particular effect, one effect can happen because of multiple causes. The light switch going off, the power supply going off, the bulb getting spoiled. And you could even escalate this to the level that, say, maybe UK has been attacked by terrorists and the power plant has been destroyed. So you could expand the causal box to various levels. So normally when we are functioning, we go, whenever we see something happening, we go to the most straightforward causal box. So the straightforward causal box would be that, oh, why is the light gone off? Probably the switch has gone off or the light has got spoiled. There could be one or two of them. But when the straightforward causal box doesn't make sense, then we try to expand the causal box. What's going on? So initially when the cows had disappeared, the straightforward causal box was, the cows must have gone for grazing somewhere. And the cowherd boys had disappeared. Are they walking somewhere? Maybe they ate their food and they went. But when things don't fit in the straightforward causal box, then we need to expand the causal box. And how much we can expand depends on our knowledge. See, it's not that all the time we exercise all the knowledge that we know. Why? We can't. Say, suppose somebody is a doctor. Now, a doctor, anybody a doctor here? Okay. Now, a doctor has medical knowledge, but a doctor doesn't look at everyone as a patient. As soon as you see a person, okay, what is this person's symptoms, what are this person like? You have that knowledge, but normally when we function, you could say we have a low resolution picture of people. Low resolution picture means a functional picture. Okay, I'm in this room and these people are over here. But if a particular event requires, then we focus on that person. And then the higher resolution picture. Okay, what's going on? If there's a doctor in a place and suddenly somebody starts fainting or somebody starts having a pain, then immediately the doctor's knowledge focuses. So similarly, now Krishna has this omniscience. He is God, but for the purpose of Leela, he doesn't need to his godhood. So he has he is transcendentally functional, searching for the gopas. But when he can't find them, then he expands the causal box. And now, like how I said, how much we can expand the causal box depends on our knowledge. So if somebody is not a doctor, say, oh, this person is in pain. This person is in great pain. But somebody is a doctor, oh, they got a heart attack. Or they got a stroke, or they got this particular thing. So the more the knowledge, the more we can, more precisely we can expand the causal box. So what happens with Krishna is that he manifests his omniscience. And as soon as he manifests his omniscience, he knows what causal box to put this in. And that is, oh, Brahma is doing this. Immediately, Krishna knows, okay. So Brahma is playing games with me. Brahma is trying to test me. And Krishna, dyutam chalayatam asmi. The Bhagavatam says that, the Bhagavad-Gita says that, among cheaters, I am the gambler. That means, if you try to trick me, I am the best trickster. So, Krishna says, okay, you have created an illusion, I will create an illusion also. But I will create an illusion within your illusion. What does that mean? That all the gopas have disappeared and Brahmaji has actually taken all the cows and the cowherds, put them in a mystic slumber and kept them in a cave nearby. And Krishna comes back and Krishna sees nobody is there and Krishna expands. And he expands as the cowherd boys, as the cows. And not only in physical characteristics, identical, but also in behavioral characteristics, in inner disposition, everything, Krishna manifests perfectly the way they are. See, sometimes when some event has happened, some newspapers, they say, we will give the inside story, the inside scoop. Now Krishna knows the inside story of everyone. Because Krishna is inside everyone. So when Krishna wants to manifest as someone, Krishna doesn't just have to maybe put on some costume or something like that. Krishna knows everything. So he does everything perfectly. So it's not just outside, but inside out, everything Krishna manifests as exactly the same person. Each cowherd boy, each gopa. And Brahmaji initially sees, oh, Krishna is bewildered, searching here and there. And then he sees that, oh, Krishna is bewildered on seeing the cows also disappear. So he says, yes, my plan is active. And Brahmaji goes up to the heavens. He goes to his celestial abode. And when he goes there, at that time, it's just a few moments pass for him. On the earth, a full year passes. The whole idea of time and relativity of time, which Einstein talked about, that was more of a physical conception. But if you understand that in Shastra, Kala is also a part of material nature. And when we say time flows higher at the heavenly planets, what it means is that generally, if things are comfortable, things are enjoyable, we don't want them to change. So, when it is said that time flows slower in the heavenly planets, that means what? the enjoyability of life goes on for a longer and longer time. So the idea is, time is also a part of the material creation, which is intended to give the soul the facilities to enjoy in the world and the soul to get reactions of its karma, good and bad. So those who have done good karma, one way the karmic good reactions come is by having lot of comforts and luxuries in the heavens. But another way is that time flows slowly so that they can enjoy the luxuries for a long time. It's like suppose somebody, you are eating a gulab jamun and then it's delicious, and sometimes you just want to, I saw once one devotee is eating gulab jamun, and what he was doing was taking gulab jamun and is taking like a small piece out of it, tiny piece, and eating. And then another tiny piece. So if something is delicious, you want to prolong it as much as possible, and especially if you know there is no second serving. And then prolong it. So like that, the heavens allow us to prolong the enjoyable experiences. And that's, so in that sense, in the heavens, time flows slower. And when time flows slower, so Brahmaji went up and he came back. Now we won't go into the in-between details, because we are focused, there this incident where the cows, and the cows ran towards the cows, and the Vrajavasis felt especially great love for their children. It's very sweet details, but we'll focus on the thread of thought. Balramji also once realized, hey, just a day before, hey, this is Krishna actually. So the illusion was so good that even Balramji didn't realize it. But then he realized before, actually the illusion ended. Then by the time Brahmaji went and came back, 1 year had passed. And Brahmaji came back and he saw that everything was going on wonderfully in Vrindavan. And sometimes, you know, some people they like to create chaos. Like they like to disrupt things, they like to shake up things. Sometimes some speakers also, unless they create some controversy by their class, they feel I have not given a class. They feel I have to speak something which will just jolt people entirely. So now, when you create a disturbance and there is no disturbance, then you have a disturbance. Why are you not disturbed? Isn't it? So, it's like somebody is a powerful bodybuilder and they punch someone. And that person just stands as if nothing has happened to them. What? He says, sir, I punched. You know, is something behind you propping you up? You should not be knocked out. So now Brahmaji has created a big disturbance and there is no disturbance in Vrindavan. Everything is going on wonderfully. And then this creates disturbance in Brahma. What happened? What happened? And he says, am I missing something? He looks, all the gopas are there, all the cows are there. He says, hey, I had put them all asleep. Did they wake up and come back? He goes to the cave and checks. All of them are lying asleep. He comes back, say, all of them are here. He goes back, and all of them are there. You know, it's like sometimes if you see twins, and if you don't know there are twins, you see somebody sitting here and you look, hey, sitting here, what is this? It's like two people who are identical, you say, am I seeing double? So if you don't know in advance, then seeing double is bewildering. But here it was not like two twins, it's like hundreds of twins. And like there's one gopa over here and one gopa over here. All the gopas were there and hundreds of twins, you almost double gopas and double cows. And Brahma said, where did they come from? Looking here, looking there, looking here, looking. And we all need to be able to make sense of things. And when we can't make sense of things, then it's like a cognitive overload. Just get completely overloaded. And now, in this case of Brahma, he's looking and just couldn't make sense. And he started getting more and more confused, more and more bewildered. Now Krishna was watching. And when Brahmaji just couldn't make sense of things, Krishna's purpose ultimately was to enlighten Brahma. It is not to punish or trouble Brahma. Just like, say, a student thinks, I'm very good at maths. And then the teacher gives a tough sum. And the student tries to figure, hey, this is not working, it's not working, it's not working. And the student becomes more and more and more bewildered. And then the teacher has compassion. It's actually, you have to do like this. And, oh, and so Krishna decides to reveal. And as Brahmaji is, his bewilderment has gone to a point where he's collapsing. Bewilderment. At that time, Krishna reveals. And right in front of Brahmaji's eyes, all the cowherd boys and all the cows turn into not Krishna but who? Narayan, Vishnu, four-handed, Chaturbhuja Rupa. Now, it's significant. Krishna does not, although they are all his expansions, he does not show them as his expansions. Why? Because for Brahmaji, he knows Vishnu is above me. Now, geographically also, in the sense of the universal geography, now, Vishnu's abode is above Brahma's abode. The earth is below Brahma's abode. And Krishna was acting on the earth. So Brahma had no doubt about Vishnu's position. But Brahma had doubt about Krishna's position. And thus, to show Krishna, that to show Brahma, that actually I am Vishnu. Not only I am Vishnu, actually Vishnu comes from me. Krishna demonstrated the whole various Vishnu manifestations coming from him. And not only that, in that vision which Krishna showed him, he also saw that these Vishnu manifestations were being worshipped. And they were being worshipped by the devatas, the siddhas, the charanas, and he saw even Brahma himself is worshipping them. What is going on? I'm here. Who's there? He himself is worshipping over there. And then as he saw in this way, eventually, this Krishna is the source of all these Vishnus. And these Vishnus are supremely worshipable objects. Then he understood. So what Krishna did was, Brahmaji created an illusion, Krishna created an illusion within that illusion. It is, okay, you have got us all the gopas to disappear, okay, they disappeared, and that is there, but he created an illusion, they're still there. But then Krishna used the illusion within the illusion to reveal the supreme reality. So Krishna can use everything for his purposes. Even illusion. So, normally illusion takes us away from Krishna, but Krishna can use illusion also to bring us closer to him. So, Krishna uses illusion to reveal to Brahma the supreme reality. And then, when Brahmaji understood this, he was stunned, he was overwhelmed. And then, he had come on his swan carrier, and he immediately descended and rushed towards Brahma, towards Krishna, and he started offering his obeisances. And he offers beautiful prayers. In fact, Brahmaji's prayers are among the longest prayers in the prayer as a section in the 10th canto. And the whole prayers itself is very illuminating. We can't go into the details. But broadly, there are three broad sections of the prayers. The first section, he's telling how, O Lord, even when you appear ordinary, you remain supreme. So I saw your ordinary form and I got bewildered, but it is your greatness that even in a small form you manifest, still you remain the supreme. And then he says, the second part is, okay, why do you manifest in such a form? So first he talks, you could say the external reason, that you come to establish dharma in the world, and how you have many incarnations, and this is also an incarnation. And he glorifies your compassion in coming to the world in human seeming forms and delivering the world. But then he moves toward the internal reason and he says that actually you have come to demonstrate the glory of the Vrajavasis. And then there are beautiful prayers. He says, how fortunate are these gopas that they eat the food directly from your plate and you eat the food from their plate. How fortunate are these cows that you treat them just like your mother. You drink milk directly from their udders. And then he says, how fortunate are all the Vrajavasis that they get to treat you just like your child, their child. How fortunate is all of Vrindavan that such an intimate form of yours is manifested. And he concluded by saying, oh Lord, these Vrajavasis are so great that I want to just get the dust off their feet. And thus, Krishna eventually fulfills his desire and the hill on which Nandagram is there in Vrindavan, that hill is considered to be Brahmaji. So he desires especially Krishna in the Bala Rupa. Because this is the Bala Rupa he has seen in the childhood form, how Krishna is extraordinary. So the end of it is that he subjects Krishna to a test, but Krishna gives him taste. Krishna gives him such, he gets appreciation that these, in what seems inappropriate to him, he now understands it's intimate. It indicates the greatness of the devotion of the Vrajavasis that they can have such intimate dealings with Krishna. And therefore, he desires to become one of them. He desires not even one of them, to become one of those who are under their lotus feet to get their dust. So he gets this taste, and the last verses in Brahma's prayers are overflowing with devotion. Profound appreciation for Raja. So for all of us, this progression is important. Sometimes we face situations, as I said, when we don't know why something is happening. And we think this situation is, no, Krishna has to help me. If Krishna doesn't help me, what is the use? I've been doing so much bhakti. But no, we are not here to test God. And it is not that we can set an exam for God. You know, if you do this, then you care for me. If you don't do this, then you don't care for me. We are nowhere to test Him. So we may not always get an explanation from God, but we can always get an experience of God. An explanation from God means, why is it happening like this? But an experience of God means that even amid the difficulty, amidst the confusion, if we turn towards Krishna and absorb ourselves in Him, then we can feel ourselves lifted above that situation. Yes, we can use our intelligence to try to make sense. Why is this happening like this? And sometimes Krishna may give us that intelligence also. But you see, specifically in 10.10 in the Bhagavad-Gita, what Krishna says is, Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam Tadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayanti te. He's not saying, I will give you the intelligence to solve your problems. I will give you the intelligence to understand your situations. But he says, I will give you the intelligence to come to me. That means whatever situation we are in, how can we see the situation in a way that we can move closer to Krishna? That intelligence Krishna will give to us. But sometimes what we want is, this situation should be solved. This problem should be solved. And when we demand that intelligence, sometimes we just not get it. So for us, we may feel that this problem is so terrible, and if only this problem would be solved, my bhakti would move nicely. And yes, certain problems they are solved, our bhakti can move nicely. But sometimes certain problems themselves may be what intensify our devotion. We don't know in advance what is best for our devotion. Did I mention this in yesterday's class? That how a certain amount of privation, a certain amount of deprivation is essential for, is conducive for motivation. So basically, sometimes Krishna may not solve a problem, and if we think, why is this happening? I want an explanation for that. We may not get that explanation. But still, if we turn toward Krishna, we will get an experience of Krishna. Now, of course, I'll conclude with this point, that we all have various material shelters. I say our job is a shelter, our health is a shelter, our relationships are a shelter, and our, of course, immigration status is a shelter. If we are in that transitional situation. Now, all these are shelters, and they do shelter us. They are important for us. But at the same time, a devotee treats every shelter the way a bird treats the branch under it. The bird is situated on the branch, but the bird is always ready to spread its wings and fly away. So we need material shelters, and we, while the material shelter is there, we use it. We take shelter of it also. But we know this is not my supreme shelter. Every material situation is ultimately meant for us to help us develop our wings. Our wings is our bhakti. Our wings is our devotional connection with Krishna. So a devotee, if we are not like a bird, if we are like a land animal, sitting on a branch, and the branch collapses, we'll also crumble. So materialist people are like that. When their whatever material shelter is there, that collapses, they can't do it, they just crumble under the ground. Now, functionally as devotees also, we need material shelters in the world. But a devotee is also developing the wings. So every day when we are doing sadhana bhakti, every day when we are trying to remember Krishna and serve Krishna, our wings are growing. And if the material shelter is no longer there, we can expand our wings and fly toward Krishna. So sometimes, why is this branch breaking? When will this branch be fixed? What do I do? We may not get an explanation for that. But instead of looking for the stability of the branch, if we look for the strength of the wings, Krishna will give us that strength. So Krishna may not rectify the material situation the way we are asking him, but Krishna will give us a spiritual experience even through that material situation. So rather than trying to test Krishna, we seek a taste for Krishna. And as we get more and more taste in Krishna, then even if the material world tests us in various ways, we won't be so disturbed by them. Na praharishet priyam prapya no dvijet prapya cha priyam sthira buddhira sammoodho brahma vid brahmani stita. A devotee who is Brahmanisita, who is spiritually situated, not just in spiritual knowledge, but in spiritual realization. Then good and bad things happen to them. You can't, life is such that, it doesn't say that don't see this as bad, good or this as bad. Yeah, good and bad is there. But a devotee doesn't get elated when good happens, he doesn't get dejected when bad happens. Yeah, these are good and bad, and they matter, but as compared to Krishna, and my relationship with Krishna, they don't matter so much. And we can march ahead steadily in our life if we are either sheltered in Krishna or seeking the shelter of Krishna. So the material shelters we have, if they work good, if they don't work, we still have the shelter of Krishna. So Brahmaji got this taste, and by Krishna's grace, we also, by the practice of bhakti, can get taste, can get absorption, can get glimpses of the supreme joy of devotion. So I'll summarize. I spoke in the second part of this Brahma Vimohan Leela about how when Krishna was subjected to this situation of being all alone. Now Krishna, I talked about how he, for the purpose of Leela, acted as a bewildered. Because in the Leela primarily, he is not manifesting his Godhood. He is reciprocating love with his devotees. And for that he conceals his Godhood. The supreme ashraya takes ashraya of yoga maya so that he can reciprocate love. But now simultaneously, we especially an influential person, not just interacting with one person but many people. So if one interaction is not going through, or it's gone through, then we look at others also. So in this, we put whatever happens in our life into the appropriate causal box. Normally we go to the most immediately sensible causal box. When it doesn't make sense, then we expand the causal box. And how much we expand the causal box is based on our knowledge. So Krishna is acting within the causal box. Oh, the cows must be grazing and gone somewhere. But when that causal box didn't make sense, Krishna, based on his omniscience, could expand the causal box. Oh, Brahma is behind this. And then immediately after that, Krishna started reciprocating with Brahma. And he said, you're creating an illusion? I will show my illusory power. And I will create a bigger illusion within your illusion. And Krishna perfectly expanded as all the gopas and cowherds. And then after that, he bewildered Brahma. And when Brahmaji was about to crumble in bewilderment, Krishna's purpose was to educate him, not to confuse or delude him. So then Krishna revealed himself as the source of all the Vishnus. And Brahmaji then offered prayers, first acknowledging that Krishna's supreme position is always there no matter what is the nature of his appearance. Then he talks about your appearance is for delivering the world from Adharma and is also for delivering to the world the beauty of Raja. And then this lavish glorification of Rajavasis whose inappropriateness is actually a sign of their intimateness with Krishna. And he desires to be he's got taste for Vrindavan and desires to be a insignificant part of Vrindavan. And I concluded by talking about how when we feel that things are going terribly wrong, instead of testing God as if he has to set things right as per our terms, we will seek a taste for God. That means rather than demanding that Krishna solve the problem, rather than getting explanation of why this is happening like this, we look for an experience of Krishna. And if you seek that, Krishna will always give the intelligence, not necessarily to solve every situation, but to find a way toward him through every situation. So the material situations, we treat them like branches are treated by birds. We shelter, they take shelter as long as they can give, but we also keep developing the wings so that we can fly toward Krishna whenever required. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So any questions? Yes, please.
Indra and Brahma were such a higher living entities, and and all levels are higher than us. They got bewildered and.
Were you there yesterday?
Yes.
So I answered that question. Why they were bewildered?
No. They bewildered.
Okay.
So, not the question is why.
Okay.
So bewildered. So at our level, how can we protect ourselves from such bewilderment of all realms?
Yeah, so if Krishna and Brahma, if Indra and Brahma get bewildered, so what is our hope of not getting bewildered? It's not necessary that we have to compare like that, because everybody will be tested according to their level. It's a brilliant mathematics student might flunk in a PhD level exam, but that doesn't mean if I am studying at the first level in mathematics, I am also going to fail. Everybody is tested according to their level. And the fact is that everybody is going to be tested, nobody is infallible. And even the greatest of people, if they don't apply themselves, they can fail. But Krishna doesn't demand, Krishna doesn't subject us to a test that is tougher than what we can pass. So if we apply ourselves according to a situation, we will move forward. And sometimes bhakti is a little complicated, sometimes even failure can be a success. That means we fail a test, but through that failure we develop humility. And developing that humility is actually the success. So we need to be cautious, but we don't need to be paranoid. It is not that Krishna is wanting us to fail. Krishna just wants us to be serious about our devotional practices, and he will guide us how to succeed. Okay, thank you.
Is it because Indra and Brahma didn't understand the Krishna's sweetness? Is it, as you mentioned, they were only concentrating on their greatness?
Yes, definitely. Where Krishna and Indra and Brahma not focusing on Krishna's sweetness, only his greatness? Yes, it requires a certain level of intimacy to appreciate intimacy. It's like, say, somebody whom we don't know at all. The first time they meet, they come and hug us. Hey, what's going on here? Sometimes some people just like this, they don't want to reject the hug, but they are like cold, you know, like a statue over there. Because they don't feel like hugging that person at that time. So it requires a certain level of intimacy to appreciate intimacy. So devatas, they are primarily in the mood of Aishwarya, in the mood of awe and reverence. And that is the mood in which they appreciate, they know the divine. So Krishna's intimacy, it's a little difficult for them to appreciate. Yes.
Can you just give an example? You say you can experience Krishna. Can you give a practical example? Like, how would you feel Krishna? And how
okay.
Would you experience Krishna?
What do you
in
mean
a
by? What do we mean by experiencing Krishna? It's basically that in some difficult situation, when we just don't have any solution, maybe we chant, we pray. And even in that situation, we experience relief. There is release from problems and there is relief amid problems. So now, how do you get that relief? The problem is still there, but you feel as if you have risen above that problem. So that is an experience of Krishna. So we all can, if we have practiced a certain limb of bhakti, then we can take shelter of that limb and we can get experience of Krishna. And basically that experience gives us the understanding that there is a higher level of reality. This material level is there, that's where we normally function. But there is a higher level where I can get shelter even when things collapse at the material level. One time I was in the Juhu temple and I was chanting in the morning and some water had got spilled. So I slipped and I fell very badly. So almost 7-8 years ago. And because my one leg already has polio, it already also had osteoporosis. So it was a simple fall, but it turned out to be a very bad fracture because of that. So at that time, I just experienced such pain. I'd never experienced it before. And I tried to chant, but I just couldn't. And I love the Bhagavad-Gita somehow. I like Bhagavad-Gita recitation. So I started reciting the Bhagavad-Gita verses at that time. And it was almost like miraculous. And as soon as I started reciting Bhagavad-Gita verses, the pain disappeared. And then, as soon as I stopped reciting, all the pain came back. So then I started reciting not because of devotion for the Gita, but because of the desire to avoid the pain. And then I was rushed to the hospital. First we went nearby to do x-ray, and it turned out it was a very bad fracture. Then we decided to go to the hospital, take almost in India, you can get a pizza faster than you can get an ambulance. So it took some time to reach, but by the time I reached, I was continuously reciting Gita verses, and that was probably the most intense Gita recitation I have done till now. One day I hope I'll do it out of devotion, but at least out of necessity. At our level, it is yena kena prakarena mana Krishna niveshayat. Somehow or the other, fix the mind in Krishna. So we all get this experience at times that, now, amidst difficulties, if we turn toward Krishna, then generally the problem comes when we feel we should have control over the situation. Then what happens? We don't turn away from the situation and turn toward Krishna. So like in this case of the fracture, it's out of my control. So when it's clear for us this is out of my control, then we stop wrestling with the situation and start trying to transcend the situation. But as long as we think I am the controller or I should be able to control the situation, then we are half going toward Krishna and half over here. Then we don't let ourselves experience Krishna. Now, of course, sometimes a part of being responsible is also trying to control the situation. But when it's going out of control, we need to first turn toward Krishna, get an experience of Krishna, and then come back again and try to see how we can deal with the situation. That experience of Krishna basically means we rise above, our consciousness rises above the situation. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, you're saying turn to Krishna. Are you asking Krishna for help?
Of course.
We're not supposed to ask anything from Krishna.
Are we not supposed to ask anything from Krishna? yes and no. See, we cannot become pure. No, no. Let me. We cannot become pure devotees without becoming devotees. So first there has to be a relationship, and then there can be a pure relationship. If something is troubling us very much, and if we don't share it with Krishna, thinking this is material, like I'll not trouble Krishna about anything material. Then, but still, we are not at such an advanced level that the material is not going to affect us. So when the material is affecting us, it is loading our heart, it is occupying a prominent place in our heart. When we don't share it with Krishna, then that part of our heart we keep away from Krishna. So we can pray to Krishna for help, but the help, we should not make our devotion conditional to the help. That means, Krishna, if you please solve this problem, if you don't, I'm going to give up your bhakti. Not like that. Or it is not even that. We can say that, Krishna, this is the situation, I want to serve you, and this situation is troubling me in my service to you. So if it can be resolved in this way, I can serve you better. But if feel that this is, but if you have some other plan, then please give me the strength to serve you. Please give me the intelligence to understand the plan. Please give me the intelligence to serve you, strength to serve you. So we can have that, always have a service attitude. But it's not that, it's not a rigid thing that we should never ask Krishna for anything. What should not be done is, we approach Krishna only for asking for things. No, it is that. Otherwise, never think about Krishna. Only when we have trouble, we pray to Krishna. See, when Draupadi is being dishonored, she is calling out to Krishna. So, we shouldn't rule seeking help from Krishna out of the realm of bhakti. But we shouldn't reduce the realm of bhakti only to seeking help from Krishna. So bhakti is like a full relationship with Krishna, and in a relationship we also ask for help. So the point is, don't reduce the relationship to simply seeking help. But it is not that, don't reduce the relationship so that you never seek help also. It's as a part of the relationship, we can ask for help. And ask for the help in a service attitude. Okay? Thank you. One laugh? Okay. Yeah.
Before we went to the working spiritual, it's
little loudly.
Oh, sorry. My voice is...
Okay, you want to come ahead? Yeah.
Hare Krishna, thank you for the talk. It was very, very inspiring. I've read that pastime a bit, but I've never been able to decipher it like this, so thank you. Before we went for the Julian Yatra, Mataji asked a question about how to deal with fault finding in other devotees. So I wanted to ask, on the other side, when other devotees are constantly finding, let's say, faults in you, and you end up feeling as if probably you're not good enough, or you know, you're not deserving of, you know, being in such a position, what should you do, or what advice would you give?
So if other devotees are finding faults with us, what do we do? So basically, we shouldn't overvalue those who devalue us. Now, of course, we all have faults. And sometimes faults have to be pointed out. But we all need to be encouraged to practice bhakti. Bhakti is voluntary. And if constantly faults are being found, then we lose the inspiration to practice bhakti. So anybody who is giving correction also needs to give encouragement. Yeah, what you're doing is not right. But you can improve. So if somebody is not doing that, then even if their intentions are good, if their execution is not good. So it's like, assuming that we have that fault, it's like they're doing a surgery, but they're doing surgery without giving anesthesia. Sometimes it's just unbearably painful. And sometimes we might just need to keep a distance from them. So if it's our primary, maybe spiritual mentor or counselor or somebody like that, if it's happening from them, then we may need to honestly sit down and talk with them. And share our heart. If we want to improve, but this is becoming too much. Like we see Dhruva had an honest negotiation with Narad Muni. I mean, told him, just tolerate this and forget the insult. He said, I can't do this. So, if an ideal, inspire if an ideal causes more regret than reform. See, every ideal is meant to reform us, raise us. But if an ideal causes more regret than reform, then we need a more attainable intermediate ideal. So then we have to either get that from that particular authority or we get it from someone else. So we all need to find out those who value us. And we, so one side is don't overvalue those who devalue you. Accept their criticism, but that criticism doesn't, we can't stop them from criticizing us. In that sense, accept it. But don't overvalue it. Just keep a distance from them. And you understand that some people, we can never get along with them so well. And they may never appreciate us. Even in bhakti, it can be, sometimes we have a service attitude, and that's important to have a service attitude. But I have a whole seminar on this topic that in devotion, we have to protect ourselves from approval addiction. That means some people are addicted to having other people approve them. But there are some people who may never approve us, no matter what we do. In that case, we need to keep a distance from them. And then we need to value those who value us. Like sometimes when I give classes, there are some devotees who are never appreciative. Of course, sometimes they give some constructive feedback. But I know at one place I go, and there one devotee comes from all my classes, and he sits right in the front, and throughout the class he's glaring at me. Then, I have to stop looking at him. If I keep looking at him, I'll be so uncomfortable, I won't be able to speak. So don't overwhelm that person is part of the audience, and they ask some questions, if they give some feedback, I will try to process it as much as I can. But if I am giving a class, I can't overvalue those who devalue me. But then I look in the audience to see who is responding. Not necessarily everybody has to appreciate the class, but at least they are receptive, they are hearing, they are processing, they want me to speak more. Then look at them. So value those who value you, and don't overvalue those who do value you. That way we can move forward in our bhakti. Okay?
One last thing in connection to that. We're told that our progress in bhakti becomes successful through the mercy of the devotees. So if some of these devotees probably are, as you said, probably might devalue us, would that have an inhibiting effect on how we progress in our Krishna consciousness?
If some devotees devalue us, would that affect how we progress? It's difficult to say, because how we progress is mysterious. Mm. It's ultimately, it's Krishna's mercy. It can come through various channels. But we can have broadly this faith that Krishna will not demand that which is impossible from us. So we can't know when the mercy is going to come, from where the mercy is going to come. All that we can do is keep the channels open and keep seeking that mercy. So the way we seek that mercy and keep the channel open is, we seek the mercy by doing our service, by doing our sadhana, and we keep the channel open by being favorably disposed. Bhajatam Preeti Purvakam. We need to have a favorable, affectionate disposition. We may not have love for Krishna, but at least we need to have an favorable disposition. If any service, any relationship is filling us with negativity, is filling us with resentment, is filling up with anger, then even if you're going through that and doing some service, that is, the channel is closed. So Krishna can't come to us. Now, of course, as I said earlier in the class, our mind will go through various modes, and occasionally we all feel dry while doing anything. But if regularly something is causing a lot of resentment within us, then better to distance yourself from that and find out some other situation where we can more peacefully, more amicably practice bhakti. So it's not that how Krishna's mercy will come, we don't know. But in thinking of some, that this is how I am going to get Krishna's mercy, if we are putting ourselves in a situation that is unbearable, then eventually our mind will say that the price for getting Krishna's mercy is too much, you just give up the practice of bhakti. So we need to be honest about our capacities. Yeah, as devotees, we have to tolerate. But we all have different capacities, how much we can tolerate. We all want to increase our capacity, but we can't suddenly jump from, say, this level to this level. So if this is what I can tolerate and this is going beyond my tolerating capacity, then we need to create a safe space for ourselves where we can practice bhakti. Okay? Thank you. It's one last question.
Hare Krishna. I'm just coming on from what Mataji asked. The Brajvasis, they didn't have a concept that Krishna was God. So I guess asking him for something, they never believed he was in a position to give something. How does it, like, or they didn't have that concept of that, you know, we can ask. They're always thinking, what can we do for Krishna? Like, if we look at.
Okay. Is it that? Yeah.
So how can, if we're trying to follow the mood of the Brajvasis, and we're constantly, like not constantly, but we're sometimes asking Krishna for things, is having that is that Ashwarya Bhav, like coming into
okay.
that?
Okay. Is it that, say, if we ask Krishna for something, the Brajvasis don't know that Krishna is God, so they don't ask Krishna, they only want to serve Krishna, then are we actually imbibing the mood of the Rajvasis? See, it's a complete relationship. Krishna has a relationship with the Rajvasis, Rajvasis have a relationship with Krishna. And there are times the Rajvasis ask Krishna also, isn't it? When Govardhan, the rains are being showered, Krishna, they say, Krishna, Krishna, you told us to stop the Indra Puja and just see what has happened. Krishna says, no, Govardhan. Krishna doesn't say, I will protect you. Krishna says, Govardhan will protect you. But they don't go to Govardhan, they go to Krishna first. There are so many places where Krishna, Krishna, Mahabaho, they say, that please help us. So it's not that asking Krishna for help is outside the ambit of Raja Bhakti. It's, see, the Vrajavasis, they are not ignorant that Krishna is God. Rather, that awareness of Krishna's Godhood is not prominent within their consciousness. I mentioned in my Bhagavatam class how the knowledge of Krishna's Godhood, Krishna's greatness, is for the Vrajavasis like the stars in the daytime. The sun is there, bright. The sun is their awareness of Krishna's sweetness. But when they need, they can draw from it. So similarly for us, our primary relationship with Krishna is a relationship of service. Now within service, if we seek help from Krishna, that's not maybe it is not pure devotion, but it is devotion and we are trying to get toward purification. So I'm not saying that we, as I said clearly, we should always be asking Krishna for help. But we shouldn't rule out asking Krishna for help from the ambit of bhakti. Just because we are asking Krishna for something doesn't mean that our devotion suddenly become mundane religiosity. There is the possibility if that's all we apply to Krishna, we approach Krishna for. But we see this as a complete relationship. And the defining flavor of that relationship is we are servants of Krishna. But even in our day-to-day life, it's like, say, if you work in an office, then you do what the boss tells you to do. But then sometimes if you face a problem, you go and ask the boss, how do I deal with this, isn't it? Now, if a subordinate is constantly asking the boss, there's this, you know, you do your job, don't trouble me, isn't it? But, the boss will not like if the subordinate is every single problem they're coming. But sometimes the subordinate has to come to the boss. So sometimes, in serving, we seek help. That's how it happens in normal relationships. That's how it can happen in a relationship with Krishna also. So thank you. Okay, can you talk personally if you don't mind?
Yeah.
So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki, Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Itai Gaur Premanande.